Well, joining us now is author, speaker, and leading actress Priscilla Shirer. Nice to have you here. Boy, I know you in your first two capacities, and now you've added actress to this.
Can you believe that?
How did that all happen?
You know, the Kendrick brothers are just guys we just love so much. My husband and I, they are men of integrity and character. Mm-hmm. We've loved their films, as have so many millions of people.
Yes.
And I got a chance to meet them when they were doing Courageous, because they asked if I'd come along that side of the movie and write a book for women. So I wrote the resolution for women. They were writing the resolution for men to go with Courageous. We got to know them during that process and just fell in love with their heart for the Lord. Yeah. So they called me, I guess it's been 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago now. They called and said, hey, will you do us a favor? Now, we have learned any time now that they ask us for a favor, we need to brace ourselves.
That's exactly right.
So they said, would you consider being in this movie? And then they explained it would be the lead role in the movie. And I was like, you have got to be kidding me. You do know there are people who do this well.
Use their training, their background.
Exactly. Yeah. And they said, Priscilla, I don't think that it's going to be as much of a departure from your ministry as you might think it may be. So read the script.
Yeah.
And I read that script, and let me tell you, when you see the film, you will see that this movie, yep, it's entertaining, but really, it's just ministry.
Yeah. There's the role, from what I can see, because it really comes out fully in theaters tomorrow.
Yeah.
The role, from what I can see, is very emotional. And that would have freaked me out. I would have thought, can I produce that when I need to? How did you learn how to do that?
The tears?
Yeah.
Well, part of it is that I'm 40. Yeah. So, you know, it just automatically.
We cried everything,
that's
right?
That's right. Automatically more emotional. But you know what? I did have to work on that. There is a skill and a craft to that. And I did have to work on it a whole lot to just get myself to the point where it doesn't matter what's happening around you, that you can still produce that emotion
you
when you need
it.
To.
Yeah.
I will tell you that I got myself in trouble a couple of times, because if you cry too much when they're shooting the wide scene, then by the time they come around to needing to shoot you have no
line.
Tears
yeah.
left.
Wow.
All of the tears are gone. So I had to start being mindful about when I chose to cry, so I didn't waste those good tears on a wide scene.
You know, I think one of the things that will be so powerful about this movie is that you see the attack being done on a family to break it up, to diminish the people involved, to even ruin the lineage of blessing passed on to the children in the family. How did this relate to your personal life? You're married, you're a wife, you're a mom. Did it connect with you from the get-go?
Oh, it's so connected with me. I was so glad that the Kendrick brothers were able to take this huge sort of theoretical topic of prayer.
Yes.
Sometimes it can just seem sort of not practical and tangible, and put it in a package where everybody could relate. So I totally saw myself in this woman who was trying to figure out, how do I balance work and home life? How do I maintain a decent marriage? And she's just grown used to doing, this character in the film has grown used to doing what's just easier. And that is putting on a polished veneer that says everything's okay when it's not. And if I, you know, haven't been that woman before, you know, like we all have at some time or another, where it's just easier to paint the face and look like everything is okay.
Exactly.
And so, I saw myself in her, and it made me mindful of my own sons, mindful. I have three boys, and just mindful of them, mindful of the fact that what happens between my husband and I, there is a trickle effect, a runoff effect on how they will treat their wives later in life, the kind of leaders that they will be raised up to be. And they're my first priority. That family is my first priority. And I think War Room brings not only the issue of prayer, but family back to the centerpiece of our minds. What sort of legacy are we leaving for our kiddos?
And in the end, while family is a strong focus here, in the end, it's about living intentionally, isn't
it?
Yes, and we get to choose that. I mean, how great is that? We're not victims. We're not victims of the culture that we live in, of the family we've been raised in. We're not victims of even the pain that's been done to us.
Absolutely. And that doesn't mean you have not been victimized.
Yes.
You may have been. But you can rise out of that, because God has given us the spiritual authority to do that in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And so this movie is all about prayer being strategic, like you said, and intentional, instead of just consistent, which is also important. Mm-hmm. But if you're consistently just praying random words that have no specific detail to your life, to the people in it, to the circumstances that you're facing, then really, has it been as effective as it was meant to be? And I think not. I think we need to specifically be applying the promises of God that connect with the details of our life, where we're noticing the enemy is at work.
Anything less than that is kind of like shooting buckshot at a very small target.
Absolutely.
You've written this amazing book, Fervent, and on the heels of the movie, and it really talks about what we're discussing right now. What does strategized prayer look like?
Yes. Well, it has to do with having a target in mind that you're focusing your attention on, and then having clear directives and intentionality about how you intend to cut that target off at the pass. Okay. So the very first and most important part of strategic prayer is to first isolate who the real enemy is. And that means, in a spiritual sense, we have to take our eyes off of the physical, visible person or issue where, honestly, we're devoting most of our time and attention and words and money and whatever other solutions we're trying to throw at it. We have to redivert all of our attention onto the real enemy, who really wants to remain hidden. In fact, that's his most potent way of getting over on the people of God, is that he disguises himself so cleverly that he knows we're going to direct all of our frustration on our spouse instead of him.
And usually that frustration is filled with anxiety and angst and that sense of, it's bigger than I am, what can I do? And we feel like we're spinning out of control.
Absolutely.
But grabbing hold of the truth that we know and turning to the one who is able just kind of puts you back in the driver's seat and you're back in the right lane. You give an acronym to prayer that I think is helpful to all of us. You know, it's hard in today's world to slow down. It's hard to learn to be still. But God says, be still and know that I'm God. So talk about your prayer acronym and how that can help us guide this time with Christ.
Yes. Well, P, you know, I just wanted to make it simple. So P, praise. Be grateful.
Always something good.
You know,
there
is something to be grateful for. I met a lady named Kristen Armstrong, who said to me, Priscilla, I try to start every day by quickly just writing down 10 things that I'm grateful for. It might just be I look outside and the sun's shining. I like that. I'm grateful for that. And she said, when I start the day like that, my whole frame of reference for the whole rest of the day, I'm approaching it from a posture of abundance instead of a posture of scarcity and lack. And she said, when I go into the day like that, I just see even my problems differently. And so just saying, Lord, thank you. And then that puts you in position to say, you know what, Lord, I not only want to thank you, but I want your mercy and your grace, your forgiveness to be extended to my life so that I can have enough grace to extend that forgiveness to others. So we repent of our sin and we ask him to open our eyes to the places that we don't even know that he needs to cleanse us from sin. Then we ask. A is for ask. Because he says, you come boldly to the throne of grace. Don't let anybody tell you that your prayer request is too small. That's right. Don't let anybody convince you that what matters to you is insignificant and I don't have time for that.
Or you asked for it yesterday and here you are back again today.
That's exactly right. He says, you come, ask, you're my kid. I love you so much. You're my daughter, my son. And I want so much to bring you the best gifts that I possibly can. And then that why is the most important of all. It stands for yes. Because the promises of God are in him, yes and amen. So what are the promises of God from Scripture that you can pull out that match what it is that you're praying about? You make that a part of your prayer. Because when you are praying God's own word back to him,
it's powerful.
It's powerful. His word cannot return void. When we talk, nothing happens. But when he talks, worlds come into existence.
Right.
So you might as well use his own word.
Amen. It's fervent. It's a wonderful guide. I want to mention you can see Priscilla in her new movie, It's War Room. It opens today in theaters nationwide. And her new book, inspired by the movie Fervent, A Woman's Battle Plan for Serious, Specific, Strategic Prayer. This is available wherever books are sold. Highly, highly recommend it. Thank you. Always wonderful to be with you, my friend. You too.